Icicle the Moon, which I liked for a while, but the longer I played it, the less I liked it, I'm afraid. There was Mario Land, Super Mario Brothers Advance. Mega Man Battle Network. Like, I got the game system when it came out in Japan, which was in March of 1990, or 2001. But then it came to the US a few months later, in June, I think. And this was one of the first games to come to the US. Anyway, it's just a very quirky take on the platform genre. If you're familiar with the Wario Land games, you kind of know what's up. They're all a little strange. This one's a little more traditional than some of them, since Wario can actually take damage, as opposed to Wario Land 2 and 3, where you're invincible. But it does still have some of the, you know, the damage effects that Wario Land 2 and 3 had. So hopefully the stream is going okay. It's always kind of a big question mark. Yeah, it looks like it's broadcasting okay. Seem to be responding to what I'm saying, so I guess you can hear me, so everything is good. Anyway, yeah, this Wario Land game, slightly more linear than Wario Land 3, slightly less bizarre than Wario Land 2, but still a lot of fun. I kind of feel like it's the sort of perfect combination of Wario Land's different design ideas. It has a really interesting level structure where you're trying to collect a certain item, and then once you get it, you try to escape from the stage before it explodes. And this is possibly the only game that I've ever played in the Mario series where you fight miniature versions of yourself. I think if I let that thing burn me, it will cause me to burst into flames, and I need to stand next to this flame block when I'm on fire. Let's try this again. Nope. So the timing requires me to work. I'm doing a really terrible job of the timing. I apologize for that. Let's try it this way. There we go. Alright. So I've broken through that flame block. So yeah, if you notice, the fire didn't actually damage Wario. If you look at the health meter at the top, the hearts, I started with 4 hearts, and I still have 4 hearts. The challenge is to figure out what hurts you, and which seemingly bad things are just a status effect that you need to use to advance through the stage. So kind of a different take on the platformer. Of course, if you land in the water here, then you'll put the fire out. But what I need to do is get up a mist. Oh yeah, right there, like that. So now I can get the pyramid top. It's all coming back to me, like riding a bicycle. Anyway, since, yeah, this is the Game Boy Advance 20th or 15th anniversary stream, I'm going to be playing multiple games, assuming I don't get too hooked on Wario Land, which is a really great game that I love. That is the key that I'm supposed to collect to activate the end of the stage. Let's see what I'm supposed to find fire here. Lots of collectibles in this game. You know, because it's Wario, you're trying to collect as much cash as possible. Because greed is good. He's sort of the Gordon Gekko of the Wario universe. I think if I had done this right, I could have created a platform and escaped through that door once I hit the plunger, but I messed up. So bad person. So I think I need to try that again. just grab the key. Did that wrong again? Alright, so blocks reset. With the key so that I can escape. Oh, there's another chest with a rare item inside. And I missed a giant diamond, which is a shame. Since I have the key, I can open up the next stage. So, now that I've done that, let's have a look at the chat. Good, people are here and talking. I'm happy. Thanks for joining us. And we're already 10 minutes into the stream. It seems like, did I mean to do that? Oh well. I guess we'll go into the stage. Actually, I think I'm going to try to escape out if I can. Oh wait, is this the one with the song? No, I guess not. I don't know, I can't hear the music because I have to keep it quiet so you guys don't get feedback or whatever. But as you can see, there's kind of a loose level structure to this game, like a world structure. But each stage is kind of unique. It reminds me a little bit of Gunstar Heroes, including the fact that this is kind of a board game stage. Where they got that idea. So even though each world has kind of a supposed theme overall this world looks nothing like the last one I was in, even though they're part of the same set of stages. I really think they were kind of a little drunk with power. They had extra processing power, extra memory. They were able to do a lot of things with this game that they couldn't do in the older Mario lands. But then, you know, like a year and a half later, 2 years later, WarioWare came out, and that was pretty much the end of the Wario Land games. We've seen some platformers. There was Wario Land Shake It for Wii, which was kind of a, in my opinion, lesser version of this game. It did a lot of the same things, but honestly, I don't think it did them quite as well, even though it looked really nice. And then there were some really terrible Wario platformers, like Master of Disguise, that it's really better not to talk about. Oops, I messed up. Okay, so here you have to flip the switches to get a Fire Wario, I guess. There, and there was nothing in it for me except a gem, which of course is important because Wario is a major. I gotta pay more attention to what I'm doing. For instance, not like that. So yeah, this kind of a like a I wouldn't say freeform platformer, but every stage has a lot of little nooks and crannies, just kind of secrets hidden in various places. And it's mainly for collectibles. This is very much a collectathon kind of game, but not in the sort of annoying way. It's not doesn't feel creatively bankrupt or anything like that. It's just, you know, that's kind of Mario's thing. He wants to get as much money as he can. So it actually kind of makes sense in the context of the game itself. I don't think I can get up over there, so I've blown it. I've ruined myself. And it does have some really unusual collectibles in addition to, you know, just cash. There are CDs someone mentioned in the chat. You collect actual compact discs, and there's a music player, except that when you put the CDs in the music player, it doesn't give you the ability to, you know, listen to stage themes like you would expect. Instead, it's really strange sound effects and bizarre animations of people making weird faces. If you've played around with other projects by the group that made this, Nintendo R&D1, it's very reminiscent of what we saw in the Game Boy Camera, which they also developed. And I can't remember the name of the guys, the guy who's kind of like the main mind behind Mario. I want to say Kiyotake. I can't remember. Sorry about that. Someone in the chat, I'm sure, will make up for my failure. But anyway, yeah, this was, you know, sort of typical of Nintendo R&D1. It was the more zany, inventive group that just kind of threw caution to the wind and wasn't really so much about creating safe, predictable game experiences. You know, you had Shigeru Miyamoto as EAD group making sort of the, like, the games that define the genres and medium and are, you know, accessible to everyone and kind of have populist appeal, and then you have R&D1 making just like totally weird stuff. Oops, and I've hit the frog. So now it's time to escape. Anyway, the WarioWare series eventually became Rhythm Heaven, and there's a new one of those coming out pretty soon. So there's kind of like this, that didn't do me any good. So I need to get a goal. Anyway, the spirit of the series definitely lives on. Just not, not through actual Wario Land games. I'm really poor at this. I'm going to die just because I can't hit buttons very well. That causes enemies to spawn, yep. Jerks. What is the goal I'm trying to get? Man. There we go. I think that's what I wanted. Maybe not. So yeah, this is embarrassing. I actually have no idea what I'm supposed to do. I thought I knew, but I don't. Oops. More damage. Okay, I'm supposed to get a goal. That's cool. Let's see if I can get a goal. Oh, I think that's it way over there. No, that's the shadow guy. Well, I guess we're going to see what happens when you don't finish a level correctly. Oh, I have to get to the end. Okay. There we go. Okay. I got it here. That took entirely too long. I'm probably going to die horribly as a result. We'll see. I'm trying to remember if this is the way I came in. I believe so. Yep, okay. I guess I will finish this stage after all. I know someone in the chat mentioned that we did a Retronauts episode. Man, it's been like 3 years now. The Wario Land series, and I probably talked up this game a lot on that episode, and I still stand by that, even if I am doing a really poor job of playing. Yeah, I think I'm just escaped into the vortex. Alright, so that was two stages of Wario Land 4, and I think I'm going to maybe try something different now. Let me go ahead and let this do its save routine. Alright, so I found a key so I can go on to another stage, but I don't wanna. But it looks like I found enough pieces to partially unlock the boss door. Yeah, as you can see, above each little level there, there's this, what is that, an octagon of gold? And you have to find all of those for every stage in order to unlock that world's boss. There's also this little old dude who is, the theme of this game is that there's this golden pyramid that's been discovered, and Wario goes because he wants to become wealthy and pillage it. The old dude is an archaeologist who wants to, you know, find its secrets, and he pops up throughout the game, and you mostly antagonize him and use him as a projectile to throw around and break blocks. It's really, it's not showing respect for elders. It's kind of bad in that sense. Anyway, so let me see. I can eject the game. I can change the frames too. Yeah, there we go. That's more science fiction-y. I'm gonna swap out the cartridge. Try not to turn off the system in the process. Alright. So, there was a request for Ninja 5-0, which I did a Retronauts episode on a couple of weeks ago. So if you saw that, you kind of know what's up, and you probably also get a sense of how well I play the game, which is not that great. It's a really kind of complex and challenging game with a fussy control system. It's a cool control system, but it's challenging. There is a request on the stream for Boktai. I'm afraid Boktai right now is boxed up, and I haven't set up the blacklight for it. I haven't had a chance to test it out. So we're not going to do Boktai today, but I'm going to do a second Game Boy Advance stream next week, and I definitely hope to do Boktai next week. So, assuming the blacklight that I bought actually works with the cartridge, you can simulate the solar sensor effect. Alright, so Ninja 5-0. This is a kooky game developed by Hudson, I believe, published by Konami. Alright, I'm at this frog boss and I can't seem to beat it, so this may actually be really short. Although, I am using the Hori GameCube D-pad controller. Oh, that was dope. Yeah, as you can see, I'm really just aces at this game. Oh, someone thought I was going to play Boktai out of course. Yeah, that's not going to happen. I'm not going to sit in the sun to stream. the solar sensor that's built into the Blacklight cartridge actually reacts to ultraviolet light or whatever the different Blacklights use, and I have lost a flag. Alright, so that was sad and pathetic. Let's see if I can leave the stage. Yeah, mission failed. Maybe I'll play an earlier level in the game. I'm so rusty with this. I beat it a long time ago, but... intro. I don't know how cool it actually is. I'm going to promote this stream again. If you'll bear with me for a second. Alrighty. Back to the stream. Okay, so Ninja 5-0. Kind of a weird game, but it's very Shinobi-esque, like to the point that it's practically plagiarism. You control a ninja, and there are bad guys. That's all pretty standard fare. There's some boxes. And your main weapon is actually a projectile that you power up twice. So I powered up from shuriken to fireballs, and then if you press the shoulder button, you can actually swing a sword and take out guys up close. You can occasionally pull through them, because that's how you do it. But the other thing about this game is that you have the grappling, and it's really tricky to use the grappling, but if you can get the hang of it, it's extremely versatile and lets you travel through the levels pretty quickly. I've reached the third power level for my projectile attacks, so I'm shooting this, like, I guess, ninja laser, I don't know, that zaps right through bad guys. Oops. Oh, I took a hit, and now I've been downgraded a level, so it kind of has that blaster master thing going on. So I collected the red key, which I think is the only key I need to get through to the end of this stage. Anyway, yeah, some comments in the chat have mentioned the fact that Ninja 5-0 is extremely expensive. It was produced in ridiculously small quantities, I guess because, how many units would you produce of a game called Ninja 5-0? Like, it flew beneath the radar, there was no publicity or promotion for it. So it just kind of came and went, and hardly anyone bought it. For whatever weird reason, I ended up buying a copy back in, you know, in the brief period of time that it was available. It was actually the first thing I bought, maybe not the first thing I bought, but it was something I bought with my first paycheck when I moved up to San Francisco for working at 1UP. It just seemed like an appropriate thing to do. And, yes, it's a precious thing. Okay, so there's occasionally hostages here. If you attack a guy while they're using the hostage as a human shield, you'll kill the hostage. You don't get any points for that. But you get a bonus if you rescue all three of the hostages on stage. Oops. Wow, the dynamite just bounced off my head. Anyway, so yeah, if you can find a copy of this game for a reasonable price, by which I mean less than $100, by all means, grab it. It's pretty cool. It's one of the more... I would call it a labor of love for the era. And I'm really hoping that Konami puts it on Virtual Console. I don't know exactly what the rights status of this game would be, because, you know, Konami bought... They had a partnership with Hudson around the time this was made, and then a couple of years later they actually bought Hudson, and then they started shutting down Hudson properties, and now Hudson Games basically... properties to put onto pachinko machines and bad mobile games. So, not really a great future for that stuff. But Konami does have the rights, and they do put stuff on Virtual Console pretty often. Oops. So, there is always the outside possibility that this game will show up on Virtual Console, which would be pretty great because otherwise it's really difficult to buy. It's prohibitively expensive, I would say. Someone asked if the grappling hook works similarly to the Ninja Rope in Worms. I haven't played that Worms game. But basically, to use the grappling hook, you jump and jump again. Instead of doing a double jump, you'll throw out the grappling hook in the direction you're facing. Three different directions. So you can't shoot it. It's not like Bionic Commando, you can't throw it forward, but you can throw it up or at 45 degree angles. And sometimes these ninja guys will show up. Probably the most difficult enemies outside of bosses. They'll come in, at least expecting it, attack you, and they can block your projectiles if they're standing still, so you have to be careful for them. To watch out for them. I guess I've already given that right. I should pay attention to some GM. Anyway, Ninja 5-0 has, I think, six worlds, I'm gonna call it that, each with three stages. And the stages become increasingly complex the longer you play. For instance, the very first stage I did only had a single key and no hostages. This one has, I think, just a single key and three hostages, and then you start getting multiple colored keys. And actually, I not paying attention to where the red door is, so I have to wander around and go into the doors for a little while until I figure out where I'm supposed to be going. Another ninja. Okay, so I've been in that door, but I killed a yellow ninja. Oh, and for those of you who came in late, yeah, I'm playing, hard to find. So that's two stages down. I'm playing this game on a cartridge, an actual cartridge, on a GameCube Game Boy Player, and my GameCube is Japanese for the simple fact that the orange GameCube only came out in Japan, and I bought this system entirely for aesthetic purposes. I realize it's shallow and goofy. So anyway, it works exactly the same as the American Game Boy GameCube player, except the buttons are in Japanese. Since the GBA was region locked, it doesn't have any impact on the games they play. This game actually didn't come out in Japan, it was produced there, and involves, you know, Japanese. Released in Europe as Ninja Cop, which is probably a more sellable name, but much less ridiculous than Ninja Cop. So I have to take the good with the bad. So I need the yellow key to get into that door. I already found a blue key, and I think there's also a red key. So I've had people recommend trying some homebrew software, like the GameCube or Game Boy Interface, I think it's called. Basically, the Game Boy official GameCube player is not the greatest. The hardware is basically GBA hardware inside of a GameCube peripheral, which is fine, but the software, it's not the greatest. It makes the games look a little fuzzy, and when you're in progressive scan mode like I am, it stretches everything out. So, ideally, I'll use some... Oops, I just killed a hostage. I'm a terrible person. Anyway, I will use some homebrew software in the future to play better-looking Game Boy Advance games on my system, but for the time being, I'm starting to decide to have my system modded because it's Japanese, and I have American Game Shark software, which is what you need to be able to activate the homebrew software. It's very complicated. This whole situation, I had to go through like 3 or 4 different cables. I'm using really expensive component cables for the system, and also have to use a D-terminal adapter to make it work with the FrameMeister for upscaling. It's not worth it. Don't try this at home, kids. It's a bad idea. So I'm running kind of low on life, so I may end up with a mission failure, especially here in a room. Yeah, with ninjas. Frickin' ninja. Those guys are worst. Alright, I will give this another go. And hopefully do a little better. Pay more attention to what I'm doing, perhaps. But as you can see, it's not a very forgiving game. It's pretty high difficulty level. It's very much in the sort of 16-bit Shinobi style. Even though it's not the one-hit-and-you-die approach of the original Shinobi games, it's still, it's not forgiving. Slide because, you know, that's what ninja do. It's not that useful in combat, but it helps you navigate through. One thing I like about the design of this game is that there's persistence within the levels. Like, if you kill a bad guy, he stays dead until you finish the level. And when you get these drops, power-ups here, those also stick around perpetually. So right now I'm powered up as far as I can be, but if I take a hit, then I'll lose one of the power-up levels. And when that happens, I can go back to the item drop. Assassin's Creed, it's not a one-hit death throw mode attack. Yeah, I've seen some complaints in the chat about using the GameCube controller for the GameCube player in the GBA games, because the GameCube had really just a terrible D-pad. I don't know whose idea that was. I guess maybe it was. Third-party developer, Hori, did make a very, Super NES-style D-pad controller. That's what I'm using right now. It doesn't have any kind of analog inputs at all. It's just the D-pad and the buttons. So it's much better for Game Boy Advance games. Yeah, the control pad that I'm using is expensive. The GameCube cables, the component cables that I'm using are expensive. Like, this game is expensive. It's ridiculous what the expenses, the challenges you have to go through to be able to just play a game like this and make it look nice on a modern TV. Which is exactly why this game needs to come to Virtual Console. So, you can just pay $8 or whatever and play it on the gamepad for the Wii U through HDMI. Like, how fantastic would that be? Instead of paying $300 for component cables, $100 for a controller, $100 for a piece of software, which, by the way, I didn't actually do that myself. This is not a $500 live stream. Since when did they give giant samurai quarters? I would definitely say that this this stream that I'm doing right now is kind of emblematic of just how ridiculous the collector's market has become, especially for anything Nintendo. NES, Super NES, N64 is getting up there. There's a lot of really expensive GameCube stuff. I guess all those tech millionaires want their NES games. Alright, so another stage down, I managed to survive despite myself. So, I can try to take on the boss here, but it's probably not going to go well. So I think maybe I'll just jump over to another game. We're 2/3 of the way through the stream, so it seems like a good time to switch over. Battles are a lot easier if you don't get powered from the stage. This part's really tough. Never predicted this fair. And that's it for Ninja. He's dead. He'll die. Okay, so I'm going to accept my defeat here. And eject the cartridge and switch over to a different game. So this will be the third and final game for this stream. And I'll go with an old favorite. Yeah, that's right. That's my transformation. That was really weird. I have no idea why the sound quality is so poor. This is not cheap emulation. Let me turn the game volume down just a little bit. Maybe it won't be so offensive. Okay. Yeah, sorry about that. Horrible noise. Okay, I'm turning the game audio down almost all the way. It's still really loud. Okay, pretty much just turning the sound all the way down. Hopefully that's okay. Can't hear the sound at all, they say. Alright, we'll try negative 30 decibels and see if that's okay. If you guys are in pain, just scream again, okay? Alright, so, Metroid Zero Mission. Let's see what I have on this cartridge. Oh, what? File A is corrupted. That breaks my heart. Wow, what is going on here? Man. Maybe I should just start from the beginning. Alright. We'll just jump into the beginning. Okay. I've never had that happen to a game cartridge before. File corrupted. You know, I think the last time I played this was on a Retron 5. So I think that, you know, it takes your save data. I think that screwed it up somehow. I bet all my in-game save data from Final Fantasy VI Advance is corrupted, which is sad, because that's like 40 hours of playtime. Okay, so anyway, Metroid Zero Mission is just a straight and wonderful remake of the original Metroid for NES. Kind of came out of left field, and is a fantastic game. They really kind of took all the things that they maybe didn't do so well with Metroid Fusion a couple of years prior, and brought those lessons learned to this remake, and in my opinion, it's probably the best Metroid game. I know Super Metroid is sort of the unimpeachable, perfect masterpiece, but Zero Mission is really great. It's really fast-paced. The level design is great. They did a really good job of, you know, sort of integrating the original NES maps with a lot of new material too. It's really expanded. There are, you know, hints for where you're supposed to go, but it's not super in your face. It's not like, here's the path you should take. Basically, they kind of say, you need to get to this place over here, and how you get there, that's your business. I mean, in this case, yeah, it's the beginning of the game, so the map guidance is very direct. But later in the game, they'll basically say, oh, you need to go to this place, and then you spend, you know, half an hour trying to figure out what the exact route to that place is supposed to be. And I was not trying to provoke a debate in the comments about the merits of Metroid Fusion. I liked the game. I did a really big kind of like blow-by-blow breakdown of it on a personal site that I run. I think there's a lot of good things about Fusion. It's just there are some things that it could have done a little better. I feel like it doesn't really stop holding your hand until, you know, four-fifths of the way through the adventure. This is a kind of let you go and figure out your own way much sooner. I don't think Fusion was actually that much more linear than Super Metroid. It just didn't let you get lost as much. But they've added a lot of new details to this game, like this right here, this passage blocking the way forward wasn't there in the original game, so you could go off in that direction and get lost if you know, before you had all the tools you needed, and that was part of the challenge, I guess, and part of the fun. But they kind of make things a little more guided here in the beginning. One of the things they brought forward from Fusion for this one was kind of a streamlined control system where the long beam, where instead of, you know, having separate up-down, like 45-degree angle toggles for your commands and having to hit select to switch through weapons, you basically just hold down the L trigger to fired an angle at which you can modify to be up or down, and then hold down the R button, the R trigger, to switch instantly, toggle between missiles and your regular blaster. And there's definitely a lot of Super Metroid style design in place where, you know, you've just acquired a new piece of equipment, So now you have to go through some sort of small trial that makes use of that equipment to kind of get you used to it. Like you just saw that with the rocks I had to blow up. The statues of Ridley and Crait are here, much bigger and more impressive this time. Although they did add new bosses, so it's a little strange that they didn't kind of do the Super Metroid thing where you have all the new bosses, but I guess they didn't want to blow the surprise. I believe Crocomire was supposed to be in this originally. People have found graphics for that boss hidden in the code, but that was dummied out. This game actually underwent a lot of changes in development. When they first showed it, it had a very cartoonish style, and Samus was like short and had a giant head. And then they switched it to more, more traditional graphics. But they kept that sort of cartoon style in place in the backgrounds. If you look in the backgrounds there, you can see everything looks very sort of, there's like Kirby dots in the background. So they kind of kept that graphical style for the environments, just not for the characters. Which is probably just as well. The original Samus design for this game looked really weird. And I'm all for, like goofy, strange things. I loved the Wind Waker as soon as it was revealed with its bobblehead graphics, but Zero Mission, it was just a strange fit. I'm not sure what they were thinking there. Oops. So in order to go forward, I need missiles, and in order to get missiles, there's actually a little bit of a trial to get those this time, instead of them just being sitting out in the open. Oh wait, no, actually they are sitting out in the open, but there is like a mini boss right next to it that has something completely different. That's right. So there's hints of the mini boss, but he doesn't actually show up until you get missiles, probably because you can't actually destroy him until you get the missiles. Speaking of which, so I can't remember if you can actually go forward at this point. I think there's something blocking your way, but let's find out. Oh, that's right, I need bombs. Okay, so you do have to backtrack at this point. Oops. That's the best idea I've had. Oh. Job of that encounter. So this guy keeps showing up, and he takes progressive damage every time he appears, and you can eventually defeat him and get his power up, but you can't just run back and forth and farm him. So you need to do a lot better than I did just then in order to beat him. Hopefully you weren't watching the stream for expert play. This is an old man trying to remember the video games of his youth, also trying to make simple jumps. So anyway, yeah, Game Boy Advance, like I said, 15 years old next week. And for whatever reason, I decided it would be fun to import the system, even though that was the exact time that I had just decided, hey, I should move across the country and find new work, find a new life. So I didn't have much luck with that, but I did at least have cool video games to play while I was not getting a job. And then eventually my affection for the system and my expertise with it, you know, the time that I spent with it, helped me get a job at 1UP, and I kind of became the guy who wrote about handhelds, so it was all good in the end anyway. How much new stuff was added to this game. I've pretty recently played through the original Metroid, or most of the way through it, and I'm actually a little disoriented because it's the most recent Metroid experience I've had, and this is so similar, but also changes up so much. So we're getting close to the end of the stream, I think, so it's nearly 5 o'clock my time, which is, I have no idea what time zone you're in, but whatever that might be, it's been nearly an hour, so I think I'll head to a save room and call it a stream for this week, but I will do a second part of the Game Boy Advance anniversary live stream next week, and if I can get it working, I will definitely do Boktai. Maybe Rhythm Heaven, I don't know what else. Probably a Castlevania game. Gotta get some Castlevania in if we're doing Game Boy Advance. But one of the good ones, not Circle of the Moon. So, map recharge, or map info. And that gives me guidance to a save room, which is what I was looking for. So anyway, if you've been watching, thanks a lot for joining me and watching me bumble through games of yore, as I am wont to do every week or two. I'm glad I was able to show off a little bit of Game Boy Advance for you. I probably will put together a retrospective on the system for the site for US Gamer, so watch for that sometime next week, and like I said, next Thursday I will do my best to do another stream as kind of a follow-up to this. So I guess I will see you then. Thanks for watching, and hope you enjoyed it.